morning to everyone. Welcome to our fourth meeting and our international seminar, Venezuelan Struggles, Colonial Past, Revolutionary Legacy, and a Community Regeneration. As we promised, this has been a course that is centered on the protagonists of the popular grassroots movement in Venezuela. And they will tell you how their struggle processes have been the concrete expression of their day-to-day struggles. Today, we will have a very diverse meeting with the description of several types of urban organizations. We will have the Pobladores and Pobladoras movement. It's a platform that has been, for more than a decade, has been advancing in the struggle for the right to the cities, and also within the framework of the cities' revolutions. There are several platforms that are comprised this endeavor. We'll talk to Iraima Morokoima. She will tell us about this historical question process. And then we have the opportunity to talk with our friends Gaby and Enriquez from the movement, the Otro Beta Movement. It's a networking platform made up by the young people in the Caracas neighborhoods. They have been working with the youth who has sometimes been victim of drugs and criminality, but they have been working to avoid this processes thanks to the network that they have been doing. And then we will have the Alto de Libis commune, an urban commune, and they will explain to us the commune. Remember that in the first meeting, we had a general overview of the Venezuelan Revolution and Chavismo with Mr. Itz. Then the second meeting, we started knowing what communes are and what commune corridors are. We started with El Maizal commune, and then we talked to the Che Guevara commune. And last week, we had of staging with our friends from the Bolivar and Zamora Revolutionary Current and with the Simon Bolivar commune in the Apure State. So we started with the central region in our country, went to the border with Colombia, and today we are going back to Caracas so that we can get familiar with the urban experiences that we have so far. I will ask you, as we did in the last meeting, to ask your questions during the Q&A session. Thanks to that dialogue, we had a very rich discussion. So you're free to ask your questions. We're going to have three presentations, but while we listen to the presentations, we will ask you to send your questions so that we can take due note of each one of them, and at the end of these presentations, we will have the Q&A session, and then we can establish a dialogue with the different platforms that are going to talk today. So let's start with the Pobladoras and Pobladores movement with our friend Iraida Morokaima. She is the sixth person of the Pioneers Camp, one of the organizations that is working with the Pobladoras and Pobladores movement, who I belong to. And well, today I'll give the floor to Iraida, a friend. She's been struggling for many years now, and you will have the opportunity to listen to what she will have to say. And to all those of you who are listening to us, we have this conversation available in three languages, in Mandarin, in Chinese, and in Spanish. So without further ado, I'll give the floor to Iraida Morokoima. Hello, good morning. I am Iraida Morukoima. Greetings to all of the struggling peoples and to all of those who are supporting struggling people and humankind. Well, to talk about what we do, it's not easy sometimes. The organization and the struggles within the revolutionary process is the main topic. How we organize ourselves and how we struggle in our revolution and for the revolution. This is a movement called the Pobladoras and Pobladores Movement. I participate actively in this movement. There are several organizations who participate in the whole movement also. We have the Domestic Workers Movement. We have the Tenants Movement, who struggle against the evictions. There are also the squatters who are occupying buildings in the city, in the buildings. And there is also the land committee. I started actually my work in the land committee. And there is the Pioneers Camp Movement, who built new socialist communities. We do this through a policy of self-governance. This is one of the main struggles that we are carrying out today. But this is not only a movement that has been organized themselves with families. We have been working in the neighborhoods and the streets. And due to capitalism, these family groups have been left without houses, housing units, which is what happens in developed countries. And since we have a larger part of the population without housing or house units, we decided to organize ourselves to have decent houses. But not only that, to build a community. All our processes start with organization, and we start by organizing the land. And this is not new. This is something very old in humanity, the fight for the land. So we started fighting for the land, but the land that at a given moment in time was deprived from the settlers of the cities. Cities are built for those who have money, for those who have money to pay for houses. This is very excluding process. So for us, it was very important to organize our people and to start fighting and to dispute lands in the city where rich people have property, have land, but idle land. Land that they had only to do their businesses, to build malls, or to build houses only for the rich people in the cities. So we started disputing and fighting over this land. And we started to understand what you can find sometimes in books and in scholarly texts. Now we know this. Not only we know this, but we put it into practice. And we realize that you start fighting over lands in the city, you are disqualified. You are treated like a criminal. And you can even go to jail. So after 5 years of fighting for land in the cities, we could have a meeting with Commander Hugo Chavez. This is why I talked about an organization process before the revolution, because we started during the period of the previous government. It wasn't possible to do back then what we're doing here today. But what we do, even today, is punished by law. But here we are. We are struggling, but in freedom. A freedom with a lot of bureaucracy, with a lot of obstacles that come from the ancient times. So as I said, we started our struggle for the land, and today we have the land. And this is thanks to the matter Hugo Chavez Frias. But we also have family units that are very well organized, that understand that today they need to fight over the land. But we also are very mindful of the importance of being autonomous. Are organized not because the state tells us that we need to organize ourselves. No, we organize ourselves because we are the center of struggle, and we are the ones telling the state that they have to support our struggle, that they have to be at the service of the people, because that is what a revolutionary government does, to be at the service of the people. With Chavez, we were successful in doing that, and today we're still struggling. In Chavez's time, he supported us on national TV, and he said that we were free to take the land in order to build our house units. And Chavez created the Great Housing Mission in Venezuela. So we waged this battle to get acknowledgement, because we wanted not only to have the land, but we wanted to build our own housing units. We're not talking about small houses. We're talking about planned housing units with appropriate urban space, with all public services. We have a decent housing unit. Well, because it's very easy to build small houses, but without any kind of services and so on and so forth. We didn't want that. We wanted to have decent houses. And we did this thanks to self-government. And we have built more than 500 housing buildings with the planning program, 4 or 5-story building. We also devised the protocol for coexistence, and we also devised the creational spaces, thinking about the social productive concept, so that the community be able to produce for themselves, not for the capital, for those who are exploiting us for a long time. So we were successful in being acknowledged as the executor bodies of our construction projects. But we're still fighting. We're still fighting because we want to have more land, and we have to defend the lands that we have, and we fight for getting access to the resources to continue expanding our neighborhoods. And within all this process, we always take into consideration the communal spirit. The spirit is very much important, and it is incarnated in the organized people who are aware of the importance of the debate in order to transform the new era, to understand, to fully understand the present juncture, which is a fight for life. Is housing units are not life. Life is what we do together. It is the fact that we share on ourselves, that consider ourselves as equals, that we have common spaces that all respect and care about. So these are fundamental issues for us, for all of us, our platform, to save the commune spirit. This is our struggle. Today, yes, we are sometimes some kind of discussions and disputes, because it is a normal thing in our process. And when we
get organized. This is like a warning towards capitalism. When capitalism sees that people are organizing themselves using self-governance systems, they understand that we are going to dispute power. We're going to take back the power they took from the people so that we can live in freedom. So to fight in a revolution is not easy to do because it's a constant struggle. We have had to, you know, to demonstrate many times, to conduct rails for our homeland, because we hear a lot about our country and it is important us to defend our homeland. And this explains why we have all a series of campaigns against this blockade. And these are campaigns that we lead ourselves. We don't need the state to tell us that. We understand, we fully understand that the blockade is killing us. We do not have access to medicines. We are having problems with public services, with utilities, water, gas, power. And we understand everything that is at stake. And we know that we need to be even more organized to ensure our life. But we have our own campaigns to defend life. So today we're defending our policy of self-governance systems. We believe that any kind of organization, popular organization from the grassroots, can be able to organize themselves and to build their own houses and to make concrete what Chavez used to tell us about self-governance, not only for ensure life, but to build a commune. If you build a commune from the state, it is not a commune. We believe in autonomous movements. And it is not easy because, well, the bureaucracy is always there. In the past, the politicians were the main actors from the right, left, and we still have the same repercussions of that system. And we are in a constant struggle to defend the self-governance system. Now, I will ask you, the technical team to play the video of what we do in the movement where I participate, and you will see what people are able to do when they are organized. They can build streets, they can build roads, and they can build their own community, organizing themselves with the capabilities they have. Of course, there are things that we still do not know and need to learn, but everything that you will see now in a very short video of one of our communities will show you what all communities do. And we have many communities like this in our country. And it has been a very hard struggle. And in the times of the pandemic, we have never stopped. We have never stopped organizing ourselves. And since we are the creators of our own process, well, we are constantly discussing on how to advance, to move forward beyond the very complex juncture that we have in the midst of the blockade. Maybe in other countries of the world, the discussion is just about how to face the pandemic, but they do not have a blockade. Here in Venezuela, we have a blockade that complicates things for us, but here we are standing and struggling. So I will show you the video now, and I'll continue my presentation after.
Mi nombre es María de los Ángeles Mejías, nos encontramos en el campamento Pioneros Monterrey. Es una comunidad socialista que está trabajando con autogestión. Hemos construido nuestras propias casas dignas, 7 torres, y hay 156 familias las cuales trabajan con autogestión.
Un terreno abandonado, ¿cómo puede estar ahí? Campamento de Pioneros.
congestión, hemos realizado en Mona lo que es todo el replanteo de los edificios, la vialidad como tal, que tú realmente pones tus manos, tu corazón y haces énfasis en esta construcción, tú lo sientes, tú lo cuidas. Nosotros siempre hemos sido consecuentes con la autogestión porque es la única forma de que nosotros podamos cambiar para un mejor vivir.
It's a very short video. We would love to show you other videos. We'll see if we can play them for you later. But I just didn't want you to see the buildings. There are 157 families there. And for us families, whatever type of family you talk about, as a family, let's say a woman that lives with her sister, that's her family, well, that's a family unit. But we always try to organize ourselves through family units in a constant manner. We have principles such as not lying, not being lazy, and in this communities, we have organized our work by family units, and each family unit needs to participate. And in the whole process of the construction of buildings, we conduct several activities. For instance, sometimes we participate in rallies in order to defend our revolution, because we understand that within the revolution, we will be able to move forward. We made a great progress with Commander Chavez. At that time, it was not possible to fully approve the self-governance policy, but we're still struggling and we are mindful of what is at stake. The state does not tell us to participate in rallies. We participate in rallies because we want to. We are aware of everything we need to do. A few days ago, we demonstrated in favor of our brothers and sisters in Chile and Bolivia, so that we can continue moving forward, because we know that we need to exchange constantly our forces and our energy with other peoples who are also fighting. And we get all this energy thanks to the debate, thanks to the exchange, and thanks to this contact with other struggling people around the world. So I was saying that we have learned a great deal about fighting over land, fighting over policies, which has been a very complex fight, and also our struggle to build what we have set ourselves as a goal. In neoliberalism, there are people who always try to destroy the grassroots organization, because it is well known that a grassroots organization was aware and working through self-governance as a fearful organization for capital. They're afraid of this. They know that when our people are mindful of everything that is at stake, those people are stronger than an atomic bomb or any kind of weapon you would like to use. I don't know if you have questions so far.
Within our organization, we build our buildings. And I was telling you about the organizational panelists. First, we make a classification of the talent of the families and the people who are living in a community. We have several kinds of skills. People who know how to build houses. People who know how to work with metal. Or who know how to work with the timber. And all these skills are very helpful. But in our community, we have brick lawyers, builders, bakers, and we conduct a census and make a classification. And every week, our family units work 25 hours a week. I will explain this to you. They work, for instance, twice a week in the mornings from Monday to Fridays. On Saturdays, the whole community works together to conduct major works. For instance, they work with the treatment of water, and they also work with the communal spaces, or they conduct plumbing works. Just to give you an example, today we're working with a community that has built more 10 apartment blocks. And in each block, there are 20 families. And on Saturdays, the families of all those apartment blocks get together and start working in the common spaces or the green areas or their garden. So we have also 5-story buildings, 5-6-story buildings with no elevators. We believe that we have to save energy and current. This is the reason why we prefer the stairs. And people who have any kind of disability are located in the ground floor. And or maybe people that the community will decide who will occupy the lower stories and who will occupy the higher apartments. So they organize themselves and we decide to allocate the apartment according to the family size in order to avoid hoarding or to avoid having many people in one apartment. We have apartments of 70 meters, square meters apartments, and the others with larger 80 square meters apartments. We have bakeries also that are administered by the community. So the self-governance system never stops, because after we have built all the buildings, we then tackle the social productive companies that we create. And we also take care of a recreational activity for our young and sport courts. And we see how the young people want more, not only an apartment, but sometimes tell us, well, we also need a basketball court. So then we then tackle the construction of those courts as well. So we manage the self-construction in our own terms. We have nothing to envy to the rich people or to the rich houses, or maybe electrical appliances. But besides that, we have absolutely the same conditions, good finishings in all our apartments. So, this is how we have been working.
So, we work based on spiritual values.
This is the revolution that we believe
in the people. We believe
in men, women, children, women,
and this is essential to face
a very important,
the complex situation we are going through. However, beyond our difficulties, we work united. So these are our buildings, worthy, dignifying buildings, worthy of our people.
Thanks to our own work, with our built own by our people, and our own intellectual capabilities. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this presentation. Well, Iraira mentioned the construction method. There was a question on the Bolivarian circles. How people participate in the economic aspect politically? How do they participate? And people ask, what is the role of the community as a whole, the role of the in the construction of these buildings and the cooperation of the rest of the community. Well, I'll thank you for asking about the Bolivarian circles. In our revolution, what is important, people are inventing new ways. In the case of the city dwellers, well, we invent ourselves. In the case of the Bolivarian circles, that was invented by Chavez. Chavez considered that the organization of the people was essential, because when the people organize, the debate starts, because organizations always existed. In the past, we had neighbors, organizations, associations, but they fought for very limited vindications, to have water, services. With Chavez, however, people organized to think. And while we think and debate, we understood that the Bolivarian councils, Bolivarian circles were demonized, criminalized. But that criminalization also reached the communal councils, because the right wing and others who are not from the right, but who are bureaucrats, they just want the people to divide and do not act. So I am an expression of the people. Iraira Morokoima from Petare neighborhood. I fought also for the same services, water, electricity, and not because of the blockade, but the right government refused basic services to the poor people. We were merely slaves to work for them, but we did not deserve services, proper services, quality services. We never believed at that time that 200 families can gather in Chacao, which is the stronghold of the opposition and of the right in Caracas. There we have a building. We are building there in that stronghold of the opposition. Never those people understood how we dared to do that. And they forget the impetus, the strength given by Chavez. So we started 20 years ago to think. Think after so many years of fear of the right. And Chavez gave us the strength, the impetus to act, to think. I am an expression. I come from the poor neighborhood, a neighborhood which is in constant struggle. But today we are to the east of the city where the rich live. And there we have buildings as well. So we succeeded in doing that because we are an expression of the people empowered by Chavez. But we also have people in the rural areas as well. Well, here we say, when we suffer, you say that you deliver, that you give birth, because it's very tough. So here we continue delivering, but delivering buildings and fighting. How, another question, how do we work with the government? Well, we believe that organizations should be autonomous. There was a time when we found a land, a piece of land to build. We were persecuted by the police, and we asked Chavez to help us, and Chavez did, and President Nicolas also did. The thing is that the situation Nicolas is going through is different from President Chavez's situation. Chavez was always in the streets, always talking. Nicolas also does, but today, well, we reached an agreement. An agreement was with Chavez. People thought that Chavez, once he passed away, he would disappear, but not. He has transformed in the people. So when we talk about the struggling people, yes, when we talk about struggling people, we talk about Chavez. But there are many things we need to discuss. There's a lot of critique. We have also weaknesses as organization. We need to transform our movement and to become stronger. We need to do more, however. We need to overcome our weaknesses, our problems. And within this context of the blockade, well, we need to do something and to perhaps sign an agreement with international organizations, because we also are part of the Latin American Organizations of Popular Housing Units. In Chile, Uruguay, Bolivia, and other countries, we have people also organized, and we have a Latin American school of popular buildings, and there we work for self-management to build a greater homeland. So, we need to build a good homeland. We are here fighting against the empire and fighting against the bureaucracy. So we are careful in what we say, but this is a struggle that should continue. And we are careful because we know that the revolution relies on us. So thank you very much for those connected to this seminar. I apologize for not giving a better methodology on our work, but I think we need a new education, a new type of work, but we need to listen to those who struggle, and we are the struggling people today. Thank you, Iraida. Before we conclude with her participation, we need to ask Jade if there are questions. Is there any question from China? Do you have a question from there, from China?
Yeah, before we weigh some questions, there are three films that the presenter would like to play.
We have a question from Chile, from the movement of settlers, urban settlers from Chile. Very happy with the results of the approval of the referendum on the constitution. And despite all the difficulties, the people of Chile are fighting for a new construction, trying to fight the relics of the dictatorship and to build a new republic. So we have questions. On the settlers movement. So we have problems with the sound system of Hernán. We can barely listen to understand what he's saying. He needs to fix his microphone. So to build a new socialist reality. So the idea is to present the policies within the movement, and this is a very important task. So this is a constant struggle. This is not culmination of the struggle. It is a continuous struggle to reach higher levels of participation and achievement. Jade, do you have other questions or comments from China?
No, we don't have any questions. But I wonder if she would like to play the free videos from the YouTube.
Yes, she could share other videos.
Yeah, now, right? I will share now.
Yes, she's going to present the videos, yes. Uh-huh. Oh.
¿Dónde están los muchachos del, del el otro beta?
That's the other beta.
Me han invitado a participar.
They have invited
pero
me to
acepto, soy otro beta.
Them, and I accept,
y me llama la atención
and I am another beta.
La presencia hermosa,
so
jubilosa,
happy.
Sublime, de la juventud de Petare, de la juventud
juvenil of this neighborhood.
Participando en la construcción de la patria nueva, luchando contra los males heredados del capitalismo. Hay que luchar duro, muchachas y muchachos.
We need to fight hard.
Con todo mi apoyo, el movimiento del otro beta. Chávez es otro beta, pues.
Mira, Chávez es otro beta.
And
Chávez is another beta.
Chávez es otro beta. Venezuela es otro beta.
Venezuela is another beta. So, this is one of the videos of the other beta friends. But before the presentation of another beta, I gathered to make a final comment. And we have another question. The class relation in the occupied site, such as the building in Chacao, the stronghold of the opposition. Have you had any confrontation with the right people living in those areas? Well, confrontations occur all over, not only in Chacao, but elsewhere. Because every time we recover a piece of land for the people, there is a struggle and conflict. In Chacao, we have constant problems. There are constant threats to build in Chacao. It's easy for the private sector, but for a movement in revolution and who refuse to see poor people close to fashionable, the Xambil Mall, of course they refuse to see us close by. So there are always threats and hurdles for construction in the Miranda state, because the right wing always think that the sooner or later they're going to go back to power and that they are going to recover those pieces of land. They criminalize us. It is difficult, of course, to take those lands and not being threatened by the right. It is clear that to obtain those plots of land in the urban areas is as dangerous as obtaining land in the rural areas. But I wanted to say in closing that the revolution never ends. Revolutions never end. To have a revolution, we need to believe that the world that we are proposing, a world of equality, where all expressions are important, where the tree, air, the nature, the indigenous people, they're all important. There's a continuous struggle in revolution. Therefore, I wanted to say that beyond all the obstacles we've gone through, this is a happy population, because there have been progress. And there have been progress now in the region with Chile and Bolivia. We cannot abandon the streets. There is no way we abandon the streets. We need to believe in unity. It is good that you showed the room better, because as a matter of fact, we are the same. There cannot be revolution with the envies and struggle among movements. We are so happy with the success of other movements. We need to talk about the commune and the other beta and our movement, we are the same, because the commune should be the basis for a different way of connecting among ourselves. There must be the basis for another type of relations between human beings. So my message is a message of unity, and unity with our brothers and sisters of the region of Bolivia. We knew in our hearts that Bolivia will succeed and will win these elections. So when they attack the Wipala, when they hurt the people react. And today we are celebrating this huge, overwhelming victory in both Bolivia and Chile. We have their brethren in this struggle, and they will never overcome our struggle. We will prevail. And to the people of China, we would like to say that we are so happy with your support to the Bolivarian process. We are fighting capitalism, and we continue struggling against capitalism. And this is also a time to thank those who listen to us, those who help us, connect us with us, and support us, and those who tell to the white, to the Indian, to the black, to the woman, to the man in our region that we continue the struggle. And from here we say, Chavez today is more alive than ever. So we cannot stop, because we are just beginning. Soon we will say that we continue fighting in the streets to make sure that the revolutionary policy will be truly implemented and continue to be implemented. And that we need to fight against the criminal blockade on Venezuela by the US administration. Stop meddling with Venezuelans, because Venezuelans are willing to fight always. Thank you very much. Thank you, Iraida. And we have greetings from China.
Yes, from China. They wish you to keep up your strength in your fight for the land. And greetings from our friends from China. Let's give the floor now to the Otro Beta movement. They will make their presentation. Who spokesperson from this Otro Beta movement? We already saw one of the videos, so we'll now give the floor now to Jorge and then to Gabby. Gabby, you have the floor. Or Jorge, I'm sorry. Jorge. Thank you, Hernan. Good morning to everyone. I know that in China, I shouldn't say good morning, but good evening. In any case, I would like to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for your willingness to get in contact with us and to learn or to get familiar with what is happening in Venezuela, what is happening today, and not also what is happening today, but to get familiar with our revolutionary process that we have been building in the midst of many difficulties, also with some advances. And every group that has participated in this seminar as scholars, commoners, and members of the different movements want to show you what this revolution is about. And we want to keep with this exchange with other people who also fight for the liberation of their countries. We acknowledge this. We are very grateful for your presence. And I would like also to seize the opportunity to thank the different brigades who came to Venezuela. In January, we had one brigade. Gabriela was one of them. And she welcomed us here in the center. I am Jorge Villalta. I am the one militant of the Otro Beta movement. And I am in charge of the political national team. There are, in this team, 6 persons from different states of our country. And there, we make decisions regarding strategic and tactical issues. Well, how does our movement was born? Our platform is a movement of Muslims. We comprise small organizations, also individual endeavors. We also work with people who started to organize themselves, not only with platforms of movement, but also with. And in October 2012, we started holding meetings with different chapters of our youth who were organized or not organized in the district in capital city and in the state of Miranda, which has a very dense population. Caracas is located, part of Caracas is located in the Miranda state, and also people from the historical center of Caracas, which is part of the federal district. So at the beginning, our concerns, well, let me first explain to you our background. In 2012, the political situation and economic and financial situation in Venezuela was the opposite of what we have today. We had not been sanctioned. The sanction measures imposed by the US administration, which is just another way of speaking of the same thing, which is a blockade, right? Sanctions and blockade are the same, but back in 2011, we were not blocked. Financially, we had the a solid situation. And also in the political realm, there were many endeavors to project our revolution, mainly with Cuba and Latin America and the Caribbean. And I say all this just to make you understand that our political conditions were absolutely different. Our financial situation was different. President Chavez was there. And by that year, according to our estimation, and as well, you all know, in Venezuela, there are social missions. So by that year, thanks to these missions that Chavez created, it was easier to address the social debt that we had without resorting to bureaucracy. So by 2011, according to our estimations, there were more or less 1 million young people. As you know, Venezuela has a population of 32 million. Now, 1 million people represent an important figure. There were people who had no access to any kind of policies or missions. As you know, education in Venezuela is free of charge. 90% of our universities are free of charge. And within the revolution, more than 14 universities, public universities, have been established. And there are missions, social missions to address social needs of our non-population. I want to say is that in spite of all the social protection that was implemented by President Trump by 2011, there were still 1 million young people out of any kind of social services or social benefits. So these people were our target. We targeted these people. Not all the territorial activities. Who are those 1 million young people? They come from very poor neighborhoods, from marginalized communities. And this part of the, in terms of social classes, they will be classified as the E class. There are A, class A, B, C, D, and E. They will be classified as the E class. They belong to very poor neighborhoods. Communities that are located at the territories of the city. And those young people were absolutely excluded from any kind of social policy. We also knew that back then, 2011, there were no narrative that would address them directly. There is not only one kind of view, there are many kinds of views. First, you need to know them, you need to embrace them, you need to acknowledge their struggles, their needs. And also acknowledge their own narratives, their colors, their flavors, their aesthetics. And that was not happening at all. It was always a distinction in the narrative, the politics narratives, between the rich youth that was always represented by the opposition party and the revolutionary youth that was the traditional youth with a great component of the ideologies that have belonged to political parties by 2011. And the youth that was not identified to either of these two factions of the youth did not have any kind of representation. So we addressed them directly. And we explained today our political work, our methodologies. And I just wanted to make it clear that at the beginning, in order to approach this youth, well, we did not use a Marxist narrative or a Chavist narrative. We did not wear, the red hat, that bread in order to meet people with the capital book from Marx. No, we approached them in a different manner. We did not identify ourselves as Chavistas, even if we were Chavistas, because of course our movement was founded on the principles of Chavismo. You know that Chavismo, it's a left upper wing
And of course, we belong to the Nazi, but we did not show this directly or the first time we approached them. They felt discriminated, marginalized. And thanks to the strategy, we have been able to work with them and incorporate them into our interviews. So in 2011, we started this our job, our work in a sense, and we started networking. We are a collegial movement who is working mainly on our territories and on poor neighborhoods. And that networking is starting, started to propose action guidelines, and we started also drafting our manifesto. We went to Barlovento, which is an Afro-descended region in our country. We got in contact with the main leaders of different territories, and we drafted a manifesto that it is valid today, still relevant. And little by little, we started devising our strategic lines of action, and we have enlarged them. First, there were 105 strategy lines of action, but over years, we have implemented many others, and we have then decided to have 8 major directives. You have strategies and you have actions, and each policy has at least one program. Just to give you an example, the directive pertaining to our organization. It comprises all the work we do to approach people, young people in popular neighborhoods and the poor neighborhoods. This is one of the main directives we have, or one of the main guidelines. And in the political realm, we have also worked with the elections. As I said before, we are an organization comprised by revolutionary young people. We have our own manner of understanding our revolution. But of course, we are Chavistas and we support the Bolivarian government. And we have mobilized ourselves in each election so that our young people cast their ballot. We have been successful in mobilizing people who had never voted, who have never voted for Chavista parties or for opposition parties, because they were not interested in politics at all. And they do not understand that everything you do in life is about politics. And since we have our own manner of doing politics, they believe that we are not really into politics, but little by little, then they realize that they have become political leaders in their neighborhoods. Well, this is just an example of the political guideline, but my partner is going to tell you more on that later. Now, regarding training, well, training is another pillar in the Otro Beta movement. We also want to produce and to tap into the different talents of our population. In the neighborhood, we have all people who are very talented in building houses. They are builders. And the people from the neighborhoods are the ones who participate in this construction businesses and industry because of their talent. And over the years, we have also given training to the population thanks to the different education missions. So we knew that there was a huge potential because because we could provide to all these populations training programs. And not only training in terms of practical activities, but also theoretical components. With our friends in Guarenas, for instance, we created an industrial city and located in the capital region. Thanks to that training program, we could reach the populations that were located in the indigenous centers. We'll talk about this later, but what we did was to create a methodology in our classrooms, and we gave much more importance, not only to the theoretical components, but to the practical work done, you know, on the field, so that the young people could implement everything they were learning, all the training in their different communities. We developed a national training program, which comprised knowledge in textile industry, car industry, stamps, audiovisual arts like photography or recording of audio material and video. We also provided training in cultural aspects such as traditional dances, yoga, and many other. There were 32 different disciplines that we were teaching them. So thanks to this national training program, we could also start our networking with the Bolivarian government, President Chavez and President Maduro understood that all the needs of our youth, and they supported our movement, the Otro Beta movement. Not only us, they also supported all the different platforms that work in the different territories. President Chavez knew that the grassroots movement were very strong, and President Maduro also supported the grassroots platform. He even signed an agreement of understanding between the Socialist Institute and the Otro Beta movement. This institute is in charge of all the technical training and productive training in our country. It's like a ministry of education. So we signed an agreement with them, which is valid since 2015. And thanks to this agreement, we have had methodological advisory in the way we conduct our workshops. They have also made it possible for us to give our young a certificate, not only a certificate from our movement, but from this training socialist institute. And thanks to this certificate, they can get a job. Our courses last 4 months. They are intensive courses, twice a week sometimes, some other times, 3 times a week, or even during the weekend. And these courses, you have 3 different levels of training. And as I said, at the end of the course, they have their certificate. We teach them how to organize and how to create productive projects within their own communities. In this way, we are also favoring the indigenous community development of the territories where we are teaching them. We have had very successful cases, people who have had their diploma and have started their own small company. They have been successful in creating their own productive space. And they have even organized done some networking with other platforms
to work in small cooperation. We have people who have started their own businesses and businesses, marketing, and others that have today sound recording videos. So the idea is that they are empowered, that they do not go to work for the private sector, but so that they become producers of knowledge, producers of talent for their communities and our country. Another guideline as sports, we have great talent in Venezuela in terms of sport activities. And I wouldn't say that this is just something particular in Venezuela. This is Latin America. We have very famous players that come from poor neighborhoods, baseball players and others. And in Venezuela, this is also the case. In basketball, which is a sport that is actively practiced in the neighborhoods, or football, soccer, which has a great impact on the popular neighborhood and other sports that are practiced by our population. So we identified, or we knew, that people, our young people, wanted to practice sports in the appropriate yards and the appropriate courts. And of course, we also provided training for them to be better organized. For instance, we created also a networking sport program, which is called Between Neighborhoods and the Barrios program. It was launched in 2014. The idea was to network with the different sport leagues. We knew that in each community there were sport leagues, but they were not working with other leagues belonging to other communities. So we decided to start doing a networking, so that we could connect one neighborhood with another neighborhood, so on and so forth. So the different teams of this community started practicing with the communities of other platforms. And we provided economic resources to create sport leagues and also a sport action. We also work with the self-construction activities. We gave this aspect a lot of importance. In 2011, we have recuperated more than 54 sport courts thanks to the self-construction activities. They also participate in the construction activities. And we do a lot. We do not just provide, for instance, all or men or paintings. No, we all work together to recuperate the sport courts. Many young people know how to build, how to construct. We work together, we paint, we do the painting, or we sometimes do graffiti, and we can then we repair what needs to be repaired. And this is all done by the communities. I'm sorry, I had some technical problems. My mom was just calling me, but I hang up already, so I apologize. So when we repair a facility, a sport facility, it is not just about the repairing activity. It is also an activity, thanks to the people
realize what their problems are and that they can be a part of the solution, that they can take, they can address the problems by themselves. And there is also an opportunity to understand the community problem. For instance, machismo is a problem in our community. You have people, you have men, 30-year-old men who are very jealous, could, you know, accuse someone else of wanting to seduce his girlfriend. These are like, I, you know, cultural things that you get aware of thanks to this community work. But thanks to this work that we do together, we get to know each other better, and we learn to understand other members of our communities, because we realize that they suffer from the same problem you are facing. So collective work gives room to this kind of social dynamics that is very important to unite our communities. The Otra Beta movement has also addressed the criminality problem. We have been working in this sphere as well, thanks to planning of some activities. We have been able of stopping aggression and crimes in our country. Regarding the productive sphere, well, you need to know that there is a direct connection between the education training programs and the production programs. Because we are training young people with different characters, and many of us who are trying to relaunch the productive spaces, we have been working intensively in this domain, and we have started more than 200 projects, small, medium-sized, and important projects in 14 states in our country. These are different kinds of problems. At the beginning, the projects were addressing the community's needs. 2011, 2014, projects that we worked with were aimed at addressing the needs of our communities. And since 2014, once we started facing the blockade problem, we gave priority to the food production, to the textile production, transport, and services. Why? Because the three sectors are the most impacted by the blockade. And there has been a lot of harm caused in our communities in the three sectors. It is impossible for our country, for instance, to import spare parts for our cars. So what is the consequence of this? Neighborhoods that are located the outskirts of our city are facing huge problems because they cannot repair their cars. Or another example, we do not have qualified labor because many young people have left our country, have fled our country due to all this media campaign and the economic crisis caused by blockade. And so we knew that productive projects needed to be given the priority. Also, the food sector and the textile sector were given the priority. Many of those projects are running today, and even if they have not have a mere financial result, they have been
been very successful in addressing the training project. For instance, we have some workshops. In these workshops, we have young people working, or we also have other projects that are not productive per se because they do not generate a good, a specific good. But what they do generate is a series of policies that have a consequence, a positive consequence in our territories. I will just give you an example of the indigenous centers. Indigenous centers are productive areas. We have established 7 indigenous centers in different localities in our country. An indigenous center is the result of a policy that was proposed by President Chavez. He had the idea of creating indigenous centers in 2009. And these indigenous centers are closely related to the communes. Chavez talked about communes in 2008, the first commune was founded in 2009. So what were the indigenous centers of production? They were centers that worked with a commune. These are spaces where communities get together and decide to work in different sectors that are key sectors for the community. An indigenous center is not a school, but it comprises everything that a school does. It is not a park, but it comprises everything that a park does. It is not a training center, but it is, because there is training that is given in those indigenous centers. An indigenous center is not a party hall, but it is also a party hall because some activities and parties are celebrated in an indigenous center. So it's a mixed space where the political, cultural, productive training and support activity take place. It is a center that comprises all the political forces of the territory, and that those spaces are made available for people to conduct various activities. It's a place where you will have all the activities, key activities within a community we have developed. We are actually developing 2 more indigenous centers, 3 more indigenous. There's one located in the Aragua state. I am speaking from Caracas, but next to Caracas, there is the Aragua state. Another state is the Amazonas state. And another center that is being developed that is in the way of construction, which is in the United States,
where we are also in the training process. These centers not only are very important for the community, for the reasons I already explained, they represent one of the 2 methods for territorial work. There is one way to work person to person, and there is another way, which is to anchor in the territories, in these endogenous centers. We therefore choose territories based on the priorities. We anchor in one territory, creating the point and the circle. The point is the endogenous center, and the circle are the communities impacted by the endogenous center. Those centers have worked following that methodology, and there are also networks between those centers. So we have a coordinating team An endogenous center is useful not only for the activities I already mentioned to serve the communities, but also they help as operating centers of the Otro Beta movement, communal councils, is an operation center, is a meeting point, etc. So we also built so he apologizes because he's taking too much time and he should give the floor to the other colleague. Just to summarize, because Gabby has other things to add. We also work in research. We do not impose the communities and territories what they have to do. The youth should tell us what they want to do, what are their needs. We have organized various national encounters in 2017, the third national meeting of the Otro Beta movement. 130 leaders met in the Miranda state. We conducted an exploration combining surveys, focal groups to assess perceptions, cultural aspects, etc., just to mention a few investigation activities. The cultural aspect is very important. And the campaign Chavez is another beta was very important. We have an important communicational campaign. The last campaign of Chavez we took because during that campaign, Chavez was able to connect with the invisible youth. And that youth recognized themselves in Chavez as someone belonging to the poor class, someone from a rural area, a person coming from their own class that included other young people. So they saw Chavez playing basketball, riding a bike, a motorbike. Chavez, like a regular member of the neighborhood. That campaign was capital, was instrumental. It was very daring as a campaign. And the proposal was very good. And it was one of the main campaigns deployed during this presidential campaign of Chavez. So also we work with people in the neighborhood named proud to be in the neighborhood, try to visibilize those young people working for the community with their own knowledge, their own tools to show the work they do. For that campaign, we have visited 8 states in the country. And that campaign is available through YouTube. And we can send you the links so you can download the actions we have performed. We can do, we have done many other things, but I'm going to have to conclude to give the floor to my colleague. In the political aspect, I want to mention the cultural aspect. Culture is a power in the communities, arts. So it is fully included in the formation, in the training process, because we work in the productive sector because of the current situation, but also we work in the cultural area. We provide free of charge information on various arts and culture, urban culture, the music
Caribbean music discriminated against by the traditional left wing. People are against reggaeton. But we need to reply to the lyrics of reggaeton. People like reggaeton, so we include reggaeton music, but we try to have a lyric that is reflect the new values. We have then supported many other initiatives in the neighborhoods. Here we have a sport which is very local, only practiced here in Venezuela and in neighboring countries and the Caribbean region. Is the those are like motocross. And in those sports, they take the motorbike and they make stunts and pirouettes with the motorbike. It is not a globally recognized sport, but these people in the neighborhoods, they work with their motorbike. So they organize competition and the best stunt and pirouettes are rewarded. They use the motorbike, they ride it as a horse, etc. They make a number of pirouettes with the motorbike and then the winner receives an award. So just trying to use their own culture in order to foster a sport activity. This demonstrates that we are not trying to exclude, we're trying to include visibilized youth historically disregarded. Since Venezuela is a country, these youth people, these youth in the poor communities have always been discredited, ignored, and what we want is to include them and use their cultural features to do so. Today, the youth have been seriously affected by the economic and financial and political situation in Venezuela as a result of the continuous attacks by the US. So thank you very much. I now give the floor to Mike, the floor to Gaby, a commander of this Otro Beta movement. Before giving the floor to Gaby, Jade could perhaps share the videos that we had on the other beta, please.
Andar en dos ruedas y ya tengo una rueda. Perspectiva de los betas. Este medio de transporte tiene su detractor, pero también tiene muchas admiradoras. Los que andamos en la misma, debemos estar claros que esa es la clave. Hay que estar claro que la única vía para vivir mejor es la unión. Los corruptos van a llegar a su hora. Los honestos seguimos trabajando con ganas y orgullosos de nuestra gente.
Orgullosos de nuestra gente.
Pasca, Cundinamarca, ¿no? Se nos llama desde Pasca.
So we give the floor to Gaby. It is a campaign. We are proud of our neighborhood.
año, de verdad me dije, ¿por qué no? Si a todos les ha funcionado pedirle al santo por la buena cosecha. Mi estado Lara es el mejor en Venezuela.
Tengo todo para ser un padre y esposo ejemplar. Trabajo la tierra, tengo los más bonitos atardeceres y el barrio, la mejor gente, el mejor cocuy.
Somos afortunados de estar aquí. Amundo Lara, Naguara. Estoy orgullosa del barrio.
Lara said, I'm so proud of my neighborhood. So we give the floor to Gabby. There is a question for Gabby. People ask, the projects are conducted through the resources given by the state? Do you, or you have your own resources? Are you self-management? Do you have projects that generate resources for you to work? Well, my name is Gabriela, spokesperson and founder of the Otro Beta movement. We work in the territories working with the neighborhood youth. They, in the various neighborhoods, they have different aspirations. We understand those wishes and aspirations. So we have 7 actions areas. And let's see where we have the major strength. First, education. We have a important alliance with INSES Socialist, and through this alliance, we've been able to train in our endogenous centers knowledge, useful knowledge, and arts like dressmaking, graphic design, teachings that could be used and learned in 6 months. In each endogenous center, we have between 21 and 9 teaching areas in order to create liberating learning for the people, for these young people be able to use this knowledge to generate their own projects, businesses. If you teach dressmaking, for instance, so they have their own business, not a slave of large enterprises, but in the local communities, together with the communal councils and the communes, we think that that is the way to contribute in order to liberate our young people in the communities. And when I talk about liberation, mental liberation, it's not that we believe in the Messiah, but we believe that people, if they have the right tools, they can create their own generation of wealth. We don't want people to work for the maquila. We think that with small businesses in the communities, they may liberate themselves. In all our formation centers, we have more than 3,500 youth people graduated in various areas. For instance, motorbike, mechanics, language, dressmaking, urban agriculture, dance, yoga, serigraphy, silkscreen, and so many other courses done with the various leaders, communal councils, and commune of the methodology of point and circle. This is a territorial policy. Also, we work in our territorial areas. In various poor neighborhoods in Venezuela, with the other beta method, we have a node a center of participation and territorial activity. Those nodes, they should have a productive project conducted in the territory by the youth. Close to electoral centers also to measure the political participation, natural spaces, meeting places. We've been able to generate this formula and they have been pretty successful over the years. Each neighborhood has its own characteristics. So we've been able to motivate self-management of the youth in the communities to be active in their communities, that they respect the codes of the youth people in their communities based on the content of the videos we just saw. That's our campaign, proud to be in the neighborhoods. We have the young fellow riding the bike to perform pirouettes. Well, that's very useful. But also we have another colleague in keyboard dancing the tamunange, which is a local cultural expression and religious expression in Venezuela. So we have the diversity of individuals that using arts, culture, and production, they generate content for the community and spaces of recognition of the youth. That's the campaign that we have performed in order to strengthen our territorial activities. Activities based on what Jorge mentioned, sports, cultural, social, productive, investigation activities, organizational, and political and education activities. So our basic activity has been for training, formation, 3,500 people trained so far in various trades and crafts. And our motto is to train as a collective, joint training. And it is easier when you work as a whole in the home, in the neighborhoods, to overcome the constraints, the hurdles, the obstacles. Over the last 8 years, we have been facing economic blockades, constant US attacks, etc. And we need to find the ways to continue working at the territorial level. Regarding the questions posed, they have been supported by the national and government, but we have also done self-management. The Commander Chavez helped us financially, and with those monies, we were able to invest and be autonomous. It is clear that the endogenous centers require investment. We need the support, but through common work, and thanks to the young people who have been trained, well, we try to find ways to maintain this effort and preserve it over time. Yes, the questions were basically if you receive support by the government and if there is any possibility for you to be sustainable. Yes, there are efforts in that sense. It is clear that we cannot receive funds from a blockaded government. we know what it is going on. As revolutionaries, we need to be self-sustainable. And Chavez taught us to how to be sustainable in our work. And that is one of our main tasks. So in this economic field, we have productive areas in the endogenous centers. We have a textile unit, serigraphies, bakeries, where we transform the raw material. And in this manner, we create networks to sustain ourselves. We understand the case of the blockade, so we need to establish priorities. What are the priorities based on the reduced resources? Any other questions? So we can give the floor to other brothers and sisters. Well, we have no more questions. I take the opportunity. I do not know if from China we have questions. There are greetings from China and greetings to Bolivia and Chile. ...1800 people in China are following us through the streaming. So Jade, do you have questions, comments for the colleagues and...
We have several questions. The first one is about the youth unemployment problem in your commune. How you deal with this unemployment? How about the any oppositional force or mafia in your area? How you deal with this problem? And also, you provide many training programs for the young people. How do you get the funding? Where is the funding? And what is the education level of the young people that you work with? Have they complete basic education? There were many commissions in education during Chavez's time. Are they still operative? Yeah. And could you tell us about how you involved in this movement? Can you talk about your personal story? Yeah, and the other question is about the, we also have questions not only for your movement, but also for the first presentation and also for the last one. So how you deal with the inflation, higher inflation, yeah. Okay, that's all, thank you.
You still have the question for the first presentation. Do you want to read the question for the first presentation for the first presenter?
Yes, because she mentions about the land, right? The rent or rentier capitalism. She particularly criticized. So I wonder who. Or the who control, or what? Who are the landlord in the city? Who control the land in the urban area? So as far as we understand, we have the we understand that the we heard some people make some criticism that the Bolivarian referendum has not expelled the bourgeois class. That means the landlord still exists. It is not a kind of unfinished revolution, because bourgeois, the landlord system, it still exists. So not only in the countryside, but also in the urban, in the city. So how you deal with this? Because from the last century, when we talk about the revolution, it's a kind of an armed revolution. So that means there's no more the landlord in the city and in the countryside. So now how you deal with this, the land conflicts? If the landlord in the city, in the countryside still exists, it's quite similar to what we posed the question for the rural communes. So this is really a hot questions to deal with. Yeah. Thank you.
Very well. We are going to answer those questions at the end. But first, we are going to listen to Gabby for the question related to the other beta. He's going to repeat the questions. Youth, unemployment, the mafias in the neighborhoods, how do you find financing for your work? And the education missions, are they still working? And last, they want to know how she entered the other beta movement, how she joined. Well, it's very good for you to tell your own story, how you joined the other beta movement, a very interesting story. Since there are six questions, you can talk about the territories and your personal history and the funding. And I can speak about the mafia and the missions. What do you think? Yes, very good. So you talk about the territory financing, and I can then answer the question regarding the mafias and so on. So Jorge is going to start answering the questions. Well, the mafias in the territory, they are connected. They are intertwined. We work with the youth without exclusion. So in Venezuela, in any community, neighborhood, for neighborhood, normally the group of young people, members of the gangs, of criminal gangs, not only they are the gangs, but they please she has to turn, she has to mute her microphone. She has to mute her microphone. So as I was saying, for us to conduct territorial work in the various communities, we need to deal with the gang members, gang members of thugs of the community. Now, who they are? Who are those committing criminal activities? Who are the ones violating the laws? And what do they do so? According to the research, They do it because they have to meet their necessities. They need to steal to survive. They want recognition. They want to be recognized, to be good for doing something. In Venezuela, as a very wealthy country with oil revenues, a lot of wealth, the wealth was ill distributed among the bourgeoisie, while the young people were discriminated against. So Venezuela, with Chavez, went from being the most unequal country to the most equal country in the region. But we still have this discrimination against poor youth and violent youth, gang members, those dominating a given territory. However, we have never had any problem with those young people, thugs. Just to give you an example, they defend their territory. Within some neighborhoods, we have different categories. We have the serious thugs, the serious or positive gang member, but we have also others who are very aggressive. So we used to talk to these serious and positive gang members. We used to engage with them and tell them, listen, we know you are the chief, the boss of the community. However, this activity is going to be good for your community. Your fellow colleagues are going to profit from this activity. We could organize activities for the children and so on and so forth. Trying to engage with them and be friendly. Many of these mafia gang members, gang organizations, they are not ideology mafia. We are not talking about people paid by the right wing. We are talking about young people, criminals, thugs, that most of them have become allies of our organization. And they have also fostered the work of our group in their communities. And some of them, they have joined us. And that's the reason they are beta. Beta means trouble. Beta means a person who is a criminal, who is someone creating problems with the police. There might be thugs, etc. A beta is someone who is performing badly. It's someone who is member of a criminal gang shooting at people or so. So the other beta is someone different from the criminal gang. They are playing basketball. They are not robbing, they are not thieving, they are not aggressing the community. There is someone working with the community to improve the situation with the community. So that's the meaning of the other beta. Beta people with a different attitude. So we work with those gangs. We have worked in jails, in prisons. Prisons are made up by 90% of poor people who have been put in jails. So we have worked in Jare 1, one of the largest prisons in the country. We have worked in various prisons with the same methodology. The idea is to connect them. So So the mafia, the ideology mafia.
Now, talking about the mob, the idea. Well, okay, Gary, and you should be closing so that we can have also time for our friends from the community coming in. Oh, yes. Let me finish the maps, the map topic. In 2017, there was a violent attack. The right left wing paid gangsters or mobsters to conduct criminal and aggressive attacks. But we decided to do a quite different thing. We started paying incentives to these mobsters so that they stay in the neighborhood working in the sport board or in social activities. We also have included other social missions. Okay, for instance, providing literacy or providing education, like in the Rivers Mission. Thanks to the Rivers Mission, those students that did not finish high school can finish their secondary school thanks to an intensive course. Because we have integrated all the people from the government within our territory. So this is what I want to tell you about mobsters. How, Gabby, would you like to take on financing topic and training? Yes, just a comment on training. We have been working with the and also the different missions within our neighborhoods are still running. The Barrio Adentro mission, for instance, which is a mission launched within the heart of the neighborhood, it's been a key element in controlling COVID-19 in our territory. And yes, a little on financing. The Otro Beta movement was financed first by Commander Chavez. We also had some support of the political actors, financial support, and some organization spaces. However, that first support has become a project that allows for us to be self-governance and to restore to self-governance. And thanks to that logic, we have been able to work so far, and we are pretty autonomous. And today, we have our own production unities in the textile industry. We have also a research center, we have bakeries, and so on and so forth. So this production unit allow us to finance our own activities. At a very small scale, but we have learned, in spite of the difficulties, we have learned to do a lot with resolving to human activities in the corporation and all the activities that we have carried out over the last. My personal story, I am a young woman from Pedai. I had the chance of going to university. Gave me the opportunity, thanks to Commander Chavez. There were many universities that were opened free of charge for all our young people. And we insist on this because before we used to have universities, but these universities were not open to the community. They were in the hands of the bourgeoisie. And they were pretty selective when providing opportunities to the poor. They only used the poor to have a cheap labor force. But with Commander Chavez, the story changed. I had the opportunity to go to the university. I studied audiovisual studies. It is a very expensive career. My family could not pay for that kind of education. I studied at a very expensive high school thanks to a scholarship I was granted. So I was always pretty much aware of all the violence that existed in the neighborhood. I was I could see how police killed our young population, how police killed members of our family, and how they looked at us. Police did not look for guilty people, but they went attack our neighborhoods just to keep us silent. And my parents, they fought against the previous administrations. And this is how I grew up. And thanks to my personal story, I can understand that I was a member of a community that I could not forget about my origins, and that I had to put in the service all my skills and talent to that community, to retribute my community for everything that I have learned. Thank you very much, Gabby, for your experience. And thanks also to Jorge. So after these two very important presentations, let's listen to the third presentation to close today's meeting with our friends from Altos de Lice Commune. We have Jesus Garcia, and he will tell us about his commune. And well, the previous weeks we talked about myself, commune, the Bolivar commune, Che Guevara commune. They are located in the eastern part of the country. But today we will know about an urban commune. So Jesus is one of the six persons of this commune, Altos de Lice commune. So David, please, could you play the short videos that they sent to us? And we can start the presentation, Jesus' presentation. Can you hear me?
Creo que subestimé el hecho de
todas las organizaciones que hacen vida en el territorio demarcado por la comuna son parte de la comuna. Y nosotros no podemos seguir pensando en chiquito. Será pensar en grande.
Y después, lo que te gusta la comuna y tal, me voy. Y aquí me engancho.
No, señor, nosotros estamos haciendo nuestra vaina en nuestra manera. No, que primero tienen esta fórmula, primero tienen que elegir el parlamento y después tienen que hacer esto y la fórmula.
Encontré que la constitución de la comuna pasa también.
La idea es que la comunidad asuma como proyecto, como indicador de avance, como
esa familia,
de la nación, de la
de amor,
de su pueblo que sea de acuerdo, es un avance de lo que puede escuchar las cargas. Si eso lo terminamos de acompañar,
y
es que así, lamentablemente es así, esto es como quien vende zapatos en una tienda y en una sobrina, y te roba todos los zapatos, pero es que no me llamo por ti, y te quedas como que
un personal en el cual la política, como se piensa la política, lamentablemente en este país pasa a un segundo plano y lo social
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Dasha Hao, I think that it's hello, right? Anyway, good morning. We are very happy to be with all of you. I see that my tiny colleagues are understood because they are saying hello. So greetings to all of you who are following us from China. I'm Jesus Garcia. I am the parliamentary spokesperson of the Altos de Lourdes Socialist Commune. And I have some notes here to explain to you in an organized manner what I want to tell you. I will start talking about what a commune is. A commune is made up by municipal commune councils. These are territories that gather, reunite almost 400 families. The persons are elected through popular vote. All the families within the community participate in the elections, and they elect the spokesperson who is going to represent that communal council. There are many kinds of spokespersons. You have one spokesperson for the economic aspect, social aspect, cultural aspect, and each one of the social or economic or spokespersons are elected. Then if they decide to work together, they constitute a commune. A commune is the unification of the communal councils. It is the addition of all the micro-territorial governments to create a commune. Our commune has 7 communal councils, and each one of these communal councils conducted a referendum to decide whether they need to be part of the commune or not. So the willingness is not enough. The fact that you want to constitute a commune is not enough. You need to conduct a referendum. And after the referendum, the population will vote if they are for becoming part of a commune or not. In our electoral process, we had a turnout of more than 50% in the consultative referendum. And almost 98% of the ballots cast voted in favor of the constitution of the communes. It was pretty successful, and this happened in 2018. Our commune is celebrating its second anniversary of our formal constitution. An urban commune can comprise 3,500 families. So we could have some 28,000 inhabitants. We have 2,000 families and 5,000 inhabitants. Another important piece of information has to do with the self-governance system. Neither communal councils nor communes
have presidents. What we have is spokespersons that are elected by the people, but we do not have a president, so to speak. When we constitute a commune, and when we constitute the municipal councils, the communal councils, what we have, the figure that we have is a spokesperson. The most important body is the parliament. In the parliament, we make important decisions and we convene an assembly with the participation of the majority, 30% according to the law. So we convene the citizens' assembly so that we can make the decisions. This is what a commune is, what I have just said. Now I will explain to you what an urban commune is. In our commune, or our commune is located at the national park called Guaraira Repano. I don't know if you know that, maybe you know that Caracas is a valley and we have a huge mountain. And our commune is located inside the mountain. In the commune, we have a neighborhood that was built in the mountain, on the mountain. We have, as I said, 7 communal councils. And in 2018, we were created. People voted not just because they wanted to be part of the commune. They voted for a constitution that we called a foundational chart. In the foundational chart, we have the history of our commune. And we also have like a roadmap that defines or spells out our goals at the short and medium and long term. So people voted not only for being part of the commune, but also voted for that constitution that sets all the regulations that we implement in our commune. In our system, we had a characteristic that was a little bit different from other kinds of communes in our country, because we started first by some administrative actions before we were constituted as a commune. Such as, for instance, the health communal services, healthcare communal services, which is our main activity and our main achievement. We were successful in building a communal system for healthcare in order to provide health services to our community. Thanks to this body that we created, which is made up by women mostly, we have been able to conduct different kinds of medical activities. So far, we had only 1 doctor's office within in our community. More than 2,000 families went to the only 1 doctor's office. Before Chavez, we didn't have anything at all. But thanks to Chavez, we had that 1 doctor's office. But after the community started working, we were able of constructing 2 more doctor's offices. And then we improved the medical services provided to the community. We also conducted a detailed census of all the different pathologies, and we incorporated more medical staff into those spaces. We did this not only to know what were the conditions, the health conditions of our population. We also conducted a census to know how many pregnant women there were in our community. And in order for us to know what our actions were to be. This was our main goal, to provide medical assistance
to our community and to know what pathologies and conditions we're facing. After this, we started working in also the food program. We conducted 7 important major research, 1 per community council. And we named this program with the name Arepaso. Arepa is a typical food in Venezuela made of corn. And we decided to conduct the program to provide to the population. And we gave our population this typical dish to women, men, children who participated in this program. Arepa is like a sandwich made of corn, and it's a very popular food, popular dish. And we can, for instance, eat it with chicken or meat, etc. We made thousands of arepas to invite all the members of our community, mainly children, and we conducted an anthropometric survey. And thanks to the results we obtained, we started identifying the ways in which we could satisfy the nutritional needs of our children. Then we created what we call a food house. A food house is a facility that is aimed at fighting malnutrition in our country. And we teamed also with the Arepaso program in order to evaluate from time to time the nutritional indexes or values of the population so that we could timely identify all the needs. This food houses provide thousands of foods, of meals to more than 200 people that work in the food program. And to all of those who are in need of an extra meal. So I first talked about health, and then I talked about our food program. And the third program I would like to talk about is the drugstore program. Communal drugstore. We had tackled the health problem, the food problem, and now we needed to tackle the drugs problem, how to have access to drugs. There was a doctor, Dr. Bermudez. He is now in Chile and he's participating in all the efforts for the new constitution. And we'd like to congratulate our Chilean friends. Well, this doctor from Chile, he had the idea of building a communal drugstore using international aid and international solidarity. So we constituted these drug stores and we started distributing medicines, and we started having international relationships with Italy, Argentina, and particularly Chile. From Chile, Italy, and Argentina, we started receiving medicines. Some delegations came to Venezuela, provided donations of medicines in order to lessen the impact of the US blockade. So thanks to these kinds of strategies to try to counter the blockade, we constituted our drug stores, and there are several activities that we conduct here in terms of administration that guarantees that there is a system where the doctors establish a system, a digital system with doctors within the community so they can have a register of the medicines available to the population. And those patients that go to the systems, they obtain then the medicines that they need to take. And they have indications, medical indications. They go to the drugstore and they get the medicines free of cost. Why? Because we receive these medicines thanks to donations or other communal centers as well. Or sometimes we
also do barter. We change, for instance, we exchange books for medicines, and this is how we have proceeded. And so far, this is the way in which we have been dealing with the medicines based on solidarity. We have also received donations from a Chinese delegation. Heather was there, Lao Qingqi was there. They came here and they gave us a drugs and medicines. We will be always be grateful for you because of that donation you made to our drugstore. And also masks that we received from China. So thank you very much for all your help. So these are the three main pillars: health, food, and medicines, drugstores. So these are very precious programs to us, because without health, of course, nothing is possible. Now, regarding our functioning, we have 6 persons, and we also have a parliament, the Communist Parliament. In the Communist Parliament, we made the legislative and executive decisions. We create our laws with the people, thanks to the citizen assemblies, but we also make decisions that are legally binding by all the members of the commune. The parliament is elected through democratic, representative, and free elections. And it was the second most important election process in our commune. First, there was the referendum, as I said, but the second major activity was the election of the parliament. We have 16 parliamentaries, men and women, 2 per Commonwealth Council, 2 per micro-government. We have one main member and another member that are elected. So from these bodies, we elected 2 representatives to the parliament, but we also elect 2 spokespersons for each communal council. We represent, as I said, the legislative and executive bodies of our commune. There is no other decision making body. The only one that exists is the parliament, and we meet every Tuesday afternoon in order to discuss different items of the agenda. We have a secretary that takes note of different items, and in the parliament, or the parliament has the possibility of publishing a gazette where they publish all the decisions that are made by the parliament. As I said, decisions are legally binding, and the community follows what the parliament has decided. Well, it was a very simple explanation of what a parliament is, because due to the time constraints, I cannot go deeper into this. But now I will explain the economic system of our commune. There are several types of economic systems. What we have so far is 3 social production companies that have been constituted, and 3 more that are underway. The ones that we have constituted work with gas, provision, textile industry, and transport cargo. We also have a body, a very important body in our community, which is the bank's community. That is like a central bank of any country. Our community has a central bank as well. And in the central bank, there are all the resources that have been created by the community. It is the fund, the community's fund. The community's bank is the economic heart,
which gathers all the economic resources. And last week and this week, we started working on a savings fund. It is kind of a tax, a contribution made for by each family. And this aspect is then foreseen in our charter. So this is why we can apply this policy. Once a month, each family makes a contribution to fund this fund. And so this is the way in which our community contributes.
This is done by the commune, but
do you have a question? As I was saying, this is how the bank works. The bank so the all resources are created to conduct social activities within the commune. And our companies of social production who respect the common law that was passed by President Chavez. We abide by those regulations. So our social productive companies produce for the community. We have an administrative responsible and economic responsible. We have another company for services, for cleaning services, and they take care of the different activities of the cleaning activities. And we have also the fifth objective company. This is the name of the company. And this company handles everything that is related to solid waste. It is a recycling company. It conducts activities in the recycling of the solid waste. And we are also in a constant struggle with the government in order to have more range of action. We need to have two trucks for recycling. And of course, we are working also in the cargo transport. This is one of the sectors in which we want to work, the cargo transport. But not only transport, as I also said, textile and medicines, so that we can produce to even export our food, our goods to Argentina, to Chile, or to many other countries. So this is what we want to do. Each social production company allocates 30% of its weekly earnings to the commune. Someone asked about the inflation rate. And what we have done is that the contribution of all the companies is made weekly and not monthly in order to avoid inflation depreciation. So as I was saying, 30% of the earnings are allocated to the Communist Bank. So the bank and the parliament allocate resources to different areas of the commune. This year, for instance, we launched an annual plan called Plan Cien, or the Cien Plan. I'm going to show you very quickly with my poem. The plant is named 100 plant. I know that you cannot see very well, but in this plan, we have several activities in terms of economy, finance, social programs, health, infrastructure, culture, education. So we have at least 100 challenges that we have identified. But, due to the pandemic, we have had some obstacles, but now thanks to the progress with MENA and that aspect, we have an immune also works with the communications. We set up a small group of journalists, young people from our community, and they into social networks. They are constantly producing video material. Evan Noyes is the one who is in charge of that initiative. So this group of people, young people, have done a wonderful job regarding communication and information. We understand the importance of communication. As President Chavez used to say, if you do not inform what you do, you're not, is as though you were not doing anything. So I think Hernan shared with you our social network, and we are on Facebook and Instagram, Twitter, and we keep our public informed. Another thing that we have been doing is that the videos, for instance, the videos that you just seen at the beginning of the video conference, these videos were taken from a movie made by Jesús Reyes and Victor Hugo Rivera. And it is a movie that was made last year, produced by our team. And it's the movie's name is Struggles and Action of a Korean. So if you want to see this movie, we can make it available to you. You want to collect that movie, you just get in contact with us and we will play it for you. It's a movie, but it's in Spanish. We want to translate it into English so that we can classify the movie. It's been translated into Portuguese. And this movie has participated in different movie festivals in South Korea, for instance. And we could establish a network between China and North Korea so that we could have also access to that community. But this is what I wanted to tell you in terms of our activities. We have a pretty dynamic community. We are always on the move. We never stop. There is something new that we have to do every single day. We do not say that we don't have problems. We do have problems, for instance, with utilities, with water, with power. We have problems also with technology, and we have problems with the internet and everything that is related to technology and equipment that have prevented us from moving faster or making more progress. Someone asked about our technical problems. We do have serious technological problems today. But in spite of all these difficulties, we are determined to keep up working. Most of the communities were born in 2008 and 2009 were born in the midst of a different economic situation with President Chavez, more favorable environment. But now we are working under a very strong blockade. We are also tackling our cultural needs. We are launching cultural programs, sport tournaments. We are also working with the schools and high schools. And well, we are ready to face the 21st century with a lot of enthusiasm.
enthusiasm. We believe that communes are not something of the past. Communes are going to be the future's government systems. The people who are going to resort to this kind of self-governance systems. We do not believe that the commune is related to anachronic systems. It is not related to the future's ways of government because it's able of solving problems of connecting with the youth. It is a very dynamic way of ruling our territories. So this is what I would do to our achievements. We are determined to conquest more victories in the midst of all these difficulties. So we are fully convinced of what we do. We are convinced also that the relationships between other peoples are a tool to advance, to move forward with all we can learn from our experiences. It is key to structure more cooperation plans, more solidarity networking that will provide pure oxygen in spite of all the efforts by the US administration to stifle our people. These sanctions are affecting the whole country, not individuals as they pretend. They are affecting the whole of our community. So this is the reason why our community has been mobilized in terms to obtain more achievements. So in a very few words, I have explained what the Actos de Lidice Commune is. So thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jesus, for from the Actos de Lidice Commune. We have shared in the chat the different social network from the communes that made their presentations today. So we are about to close today's meeting, which has had three major presentations, very rich meeting. But before we close today's meeting, we will answer some of the questions, and we want to ask the panelists also to share their questions from China. If you have questions, you can ask your questions now. Thank you. Gavin, do you have, is there any question you would like to ask?
Because in China, now we have many audience, they are particularly young people. So we have a question particularly for Jesus, because he is very young and very energetic, and he is involved in the social networking. So we would like to know why he is so involved in this movement. And then he mentioned he is a very committed charismos. So can you explain a little bit more how he has a young people involved in this social movement?
Is that all? Is there any other question? Well, we also have greetings from Mexico. Okay, I have at least one question for each panelist. As you can see, we are today with the Pobladores Movement Commune, Alto de Lidice Commune, and the Otro Beta Commune. The first question was for the Pobladores movement, but this question can also be addressed to the other movements. This is a question that has to do with the land. There was one question
on the landowners, who are the landlords in Venezuela, and how do you address this problem in the cities? And from China, they also ask, how can we compare the landship system in China, where the land belongs to the state or to the community, with what is happening in Venezuela? In the case of Venezuela, the law is different. So they want to know, how do we address that issue because of the existence of the bourgeoisie that still owns the land? This is one question. The other question is to our friend from the Otro Beta movement. There was a question on criminality. Someone says in Mexico that the crime has to do with the narcotraffic culture. And the case of Mexico, they have a very serious problem with that. But he also says that the youth can also embrace a revolutionary process. So the question is, what are the strategies used by the Otro Beta movement to tackle the criminality issue? And to close, we have a couple of questions for Jesus in China. And someone wanted us to share the link of the movie. We will see then with our colleagues from the technical staff what can be done. But the question to Jesus is, he's such a young leader. How did you get involved with the grassroots movement and with the commune being so young? And the youth also. You said that within the commune there were many young people. But the question is, how do you get the young people to participate in all the activities that are carried out by the commune? So these were all the questions that were asked. We will now give the floor to each one of our panelists, and we will start with Iraida, then Gabi, and Jesus to finish our meeting. Iraida, you have the floor. Well, I thought I had answered that question, but it's okay. Before Chavez, we had many landlords. In the times of Ezequiel Zamora in the 19th century, he had a slogan. The slogan was man and free land. But today we have transformed that slogan. We say free family, man and land. There used to be very important lands that were in the hands of some private companies. There was a major company called Polar. This company used to have large extensions of land, but thanks to the work we did with President Chavez, we recuperated a vast extension of land where now live more than 100 families. In China, I've been told that land belongs to the state and is allocated to the people. In Venezuela, we have made great progress. We're not there yet. We have made some progress in terms of some lots of land that were expropriated, and now they have been given to the collective property. There are some legal issues that are pending for a solution, but there are many land. There is a lot of land in the city available, but idle land. And we have been able of
building 3 million inhabitants, and we could build even more housing units if we could continue with expropriation regime. It is key for us to be granted land, to be granted land in terms of collective property, because if you use the collective property in the law, you cannot sell that land. And this is what we want, because we do not want to remain within the principle of a collective ownership of the land. So, and the communes and the grassroots, we have been working with the families. The families make important contributions. Because of this, the current situation, we have been saving in order to work the land. We also have a different kinds of food programs. And also we have bought machinery. Machinery that was transferred or obtained thanks to some agreements with China. And we have been given those machines. So we have a different kind of machines, tractors, vehicles that we use for the land production. We have a concrete machine. And for us, that is key. It's essential, because we are given the tools so that we can work the land. And for us, it will be great if we could have some kind of exchange program so that we can have access, we can still have an access to that machinery. Thanks to those machines and those tools, we have been able to construct our housing units. All the principles that were handed over to us by Zamora are pretty much alive within our convictions. We know that we will continue in the fight, in this fight, in the struggle. And I know that we will continue working together in our community. All those idle lands are going to be in the hands of our people, for them to work and them. So, well, this is what I wanted to say. Thank you very much for being there. Thank you very much for this exchange. And I could give you more information on the struggle, but we have some time constraints, but you are right. The major fight that we have is a fight against the landowners. Sometimes they don't even live in the country, but they still hold on to those idle lands. Like the Mendoza guy from the company I told you about, Polar. And they even started a lawsuit against us for us to give them back the land, but we are not going to do that. You can rest assured that we will hold on to the land. So this is everything I want to tell you. Thank you very much. Greetings from my heart. And now I will give the floor to Jorge or to Gabby, who will now explain and will now answer the other questions.
We seem to have some problems with Jorge's connection and Gabby. So I will give the floor to Jesus. While we wait for Jorge and Gabby. Well, I'm going to answer the questions. We will give you the link for the movie.
Since this movie is being what we will distributed. Do is,
since we are distributing this movie right now.
And while we wait for to show this movie in the movie theaters, this cannot be distributed yet. So we are linking with the social net, social movements in the world, in South Korea, for instance, and then to show this movie. So there are various ways to communicate. One, the social networks of the commune. Hernan sent the information and also through WhatsApp we can communicate.
Maybe with in WhatsApp,
Mexico, Chile, and so on. And through chat, we're going to give you the phone number for chat for WhatsApp. So you can make your request, and we can send the movie to organize to groupings who can project the movie in any place they wish. That's the way for you to send the link. How I got to the commune? Well, I started meditating when I was very young.
You know, participated in the
and since 2016, I decided
2016
to
I decided
join and create a commune. And through
and I have been permanently working ever
and
since.
Permanent work. I became a leader
there.
And the creation of the commune was very important because this is the ideal place, as Chavez said, to lay down the foundations of a true socialist revolution.
In order to relaunch the revolution,
as he said in his famous address,
when he talked about
called the change of tack. So we decided there was time to foster at least one commune in my community in La Pastora. And so far, it's been very hard, a lot of work,
but
it has yielded concrete results, and we are very happy. Now, the connections of the youth with the community, the links are very diverse. First, sport activities. Second, culture activities. They are very important for them. Also, through the economy, jobs created by the commune, well, these young people decide to participate through those jobs, and that's very important. One of the main attractions of the communes is the economic activities, and also the interest they have in helping the other, help the community. In December, we're going to celebrate Christmas, we're going to distribute gifts to the children, toys that we receive from the government, but also we have purchased ourselves. So the youth are responsible for distributing the toys to the children during Christmas. They are going to perform social work, and little by little, they become leaders of their respective communities. Leadership should be comprehensive. And of course, we have the journalists, the reporters, little reporters, young people up to 15 years old. Those are the seeds of the community, and that organic process with the youth, perhaps it is not as massive as the Otro Beta. However, little by little, we are attracting the youth, especially through these tough times. These are some answers to your questions, and thank you very much for your support. These spaces are very important because in this manner, you can see the other Venezuela. Sometimes we have problems to connect with so many people around the world. So this is a major opportunity to do so, to reach out. Let's keep in touch through these means, but also through WhatsApp. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much to Jesus, to Iraida. I think Jorge and Gabby have not resolved the connection issues. Therefore, I think we can close this session. This session has been pretty long. Jesus is sharing through the chat the contact numbers so we can coordinate this documentary on the communes for those interested, and also to remain in touch with these organizations. I'm going to share this link so you have the contact of Jesus before closing. And I'd like to stress and thank the panelists. Thanks to the organizers. Thanks to the interpreters. One of the elements we discussed today are pertinent for the coming meeting on violence, strategic organization to resist, to fend off organized gangs, narco traffickers, and so on. The fight, the struggle for the land, that's of the essence. And as a result of another initiative of an international seminar of popular economy, we will be sharing an interview with Chin Lau and Jade on the fight on land, the agrarian reform, land reform. We will be sharing a link on this. And the commune remains a main topic. And the next seminar will be using a documentary, an international launch of the communes in Barcelona state. We've been working over the last months, on the last meetings with West Venezuela. Next time we're going to work with Eastern Venezuela. This is very important to work with those who created this documentary, the people, the local authorities who participated in the documentary. So you are cordially invited to be part of this seminar next week that we keep on sharing. And those who are not able to follow this seminar, you could then go to YouTube, to ALBA TV, and there you will be able to see this seminar, past sessions. So we have 1,500 people in China and close to 550 people following us through Zoom and others through YouTube in ALBA TV. Thank you very much again. Commune or nothing, we will prevail. And as Jesus said, sheshe. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.